Hello and welcome back to Public Access. We are on episode 9. Woof. And we left off on a doozy. Let's go do a quick recap. Y'all started off at the Pancake Cave, recovering from the Escondido situation with, or the Debbie situation, really. Parker confessed to being in jail for 5 years for vehicular manslaughter, or alleged vehicular manslaughter, because they don't remember much about what happened. David was kind of a dick, is what I wrote down.
That's an understatement.
Erica and Billy. Erica fucked off to the bathroom and met our friend in the gray suit on the way back, who gave her an envelope to give to David, which she threw on the table. David went off to look for Mr. Gray, and while the respective people were gone, there was a little bit of conversation about relationship status, and kind of just getting the beat on where that was. Y'all split up. Michael and Erica went to check out the lake. Parker and David went to check out Playa Morado. At the lake, the owner, Billy James, jumped you, said that Emily had disappeared in the last couple of days and they're taking care of it themselves. He tried to get you to leave. Y'all called the sheriff. Sheriff showed up, gave him what for, and you were able to sneak off. David and Parker went to talk to Dutch Baxter at the real estate. But he was not there. Kim was there, his wife instead. Expressed concern about Escondido burning down. Where was I? David did the talk and convinced her to show them the model home over at Mahogany Place. And so you went off and did that. Back at the lake, y'all snuck away to the lakeshore for a little bit. Erica stuck her feet in the lake and got grabbed by the monster, which looked like getting all staticked and pixeled out. We did not turn a key for that. And Michael saved her by pulling her out. But she was out for a little bit and didn't know, and she woke up with her clothes all wet. At the model home is really, fake and set up. You found a clue that water from the faucets was yellow coming out of there, and y'all asked Kim if the murder house was available. She said probably not yet, but showed it to you anyway. You looked around, went upstairs, rolled poorly for an investigation move, which brought out Maynard, who showed up and started yelling at Kim for letting y'all into the house. David didn't want any of this, got involved, got between Maynard and Kim, but got headbutted in the process and knocked down. Not a concussion. Kim decided she wanted no part of this, left, and Parker calmed him down. Y'all went to hang out at Bonifacio's for a little bit while you called Michael and Erica to come pick you up. At the lake, you found Emily's bunk, poked around in her trunk a little bit, and found a couple things. You found a bunch of stuffed animals that were just soaked, waterlogged. You also found an old journal from a conquistador that talked about someone dressed strangely showing up and expiring from burns that they got from somewhere. There was a nostalgic scene between David and Parker. You found a receipt with a note that just said, "Watch out" on it. And then it was dusk. We answered the lurker question, where are the kids? They're at the school in the boiler room. So you tied yourself together, jumped into the lake with the yellow mist, and everyone dissolved like sugar in the lake. So we turned a key. led to showing up in the boiler room of the school. Apparently, there's a ruckus above. Everything's very steamy and wet and drippy. You went upstairs to find the gymnasium on fire with a prom in progress. The doors were locked. It was a bad scene. The counselor from the lake that you found earlier kind of streaked themselves down the door. David busted in and had to turn a key to keep from being immolated as the fire expanded. And Erica had the bright idea to try to burn the lurker mist away with a fire extinguisher and a lighter. That somehow worked a bit. But as that happened, you realized the clock ticked back and the gymnasium reset and reignited. So this may be the only moment that exists in this place that you found yourself in. We also found out that David's parents are Russian spies, so that's fun. Cool. So let's pick up from where we left off, which was in the hallway outside the gymnasium, which has just newly burst into flames. Again, you answered the question. Where the creature's lair is at, and you can resolve the mystery by finding the bodies or remains of the missing children. Then, if you wish, find a way to contain or destroy the lurker. Cool, so I think everyone is there in the hallway. The gymnasium has just gone up again, and the mist is starting to creep back in, I think. What would y'all like to do?
Are we aware that there was just a time loop? Or is it just one of those we find ourselves?
Yeah, there? I think you are outside of it because you're kind of intruders into this space. And yeah, so you see the whole thing click back and reset.
Is there a fire alarm in the gymnasium?
Is there a fire alarm? I think the fire alarm is going off. The clanging is happening as the screams increase in volume and people start banging on the door trying to get out.
I think this is the point where, go for it.
Go ahead.
I say this is the point where Erica definitely starts freaking out, like, oh my God, did you guys just see what just happened? It just started over. So this is both equal parts terrifying and yay opportunity.
I don't know what's going on. We have to get these people out of here somehow.
I think her immediate response would be just like start smashing at the door with the empty fire extinguisher.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think you're able to knock the windows out for sure. And if you want to, you can probably reach around and grab the doorknobs inside. It is very hot in there. The flame, it's not full inferno yet, but the place is on fire.
Yeah, definitely take off my blazer, wrap it around my hand try to pop the door.
Yeah, you can do that without a roll, I think. Yeah, and it's interesting. The doors open, and you see some people notice it. Like people are trying to get out the other windows, trying to just running around, being on fire. A few adults and kids, none of whom you recognize, notice that the door is open, and they start running towards you. Some of them are smoking. Some of them have a dress has caught fire or something. Do you do anything as they run towards you? Or run towards the open door more?
Yeah, Michael will put his hand out to try to help.
Awesome. So the first one to get to you is a boy, a teenager, and he is wearing kind of like a blue tuxedo, a pale blue tuxedo with like the frills in the front. And it's, you know, smoking in his he's got, it's unclear if it's soot or burns on him. And he grabs your hand and starts coming through the door. And as he comes through the door, his grasp just sort of disappears and he vanishes when he crosses the threshold. And his eyes go wide as he realizes what's happening.
Yeah, Michael does like the, he'll freeze, I think. He's just kind of like frozen in that spot in the doorway.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and you see that as other people try to go out, like a few of them go through the threshold and vanish. And after a few of them do that, it's almost as if they stop noticing that door.
Can we enter the gymnasium?
Yeah, sure. Go for it. It is on fire, and it's going to be very hot and dangerous.
I think I take my jacket, put it up to my mouth, try and block some of the smoke, mm-hmm. and I want to see if I can find the shirtless camp counselor again.
Oh, interesting. Yeah, what are you afraid might happen if the shirt over your mouth isn't enough? Keep yourself from succumbing to the smoke and flames.
I breathe in some of the lurker's yellow mist and Ooh. Remind her that I am still the next victim.
Yeah.
What are you doing?
I think it's worse than that.
Oh no.
When you do that, it anchors you to this this gymnasium and you're unable to leave without disappearing.
All right.
I think this is going to be a vitality roll because it's okay. You're preventing health stuff.
Make an argument for sensitivity.
Yeah. To avoid being pinned in the space.
Yeah.
Totally take that. Yeah.
All right. Say a little prayer.
David, what are you doing? You are going to get trapped in there.
Yes, he is.
He jinxed me.
Cool. Yeah. So you're looking for the counselor.
Yeah.
And yeah, you definitely find him. It's unclear if it's the same guy or not. He looks very much the same. He's not wearing a shirt. He is wearing some sun trunks. His face is kind of a little bit blurry somehow. And as you grab him, you know, he kind of embraces you and his face sort of elongates and like turns into like a really weird smile. And you find yourself in a desert. It's nighttime. The stars are in the wrong place. It's really clear that like the Milky Way is not where it's supposed to be. And you turn around, or rather the kid turns you around and points you to where there are people sort of dancing around a fire. And behind them, it's really hard to see. It looks like a mountain or something at first, but then you realize it is a giant pillar, probably 80 feet across and just going into the sky, made of skin, and it is screaming somehow. And I don't think you're coming back from there. Would you like to turn a key?
Let's go with that.
What do we got?
A flashback showing your latchkey kid routine whenever you got home from school.
Nice.
I think David would get home. His parents wouldn't be there because they were at the travel agency. His sister by now would also probably have gone to tutoring, but she'd leave a grilled cheese sandwich back for him. And he would just, you know, eat, study, and watch what's the most all-American TV show you can think of from the 80s.
Like Family Ties, something like that.
Something like that, yeah. specifically the episode where I don't know, the teacher goes to tell them about the Challenger explosion.
Nice. All right. So you turn the key. You still see all that happen. And when you kind of like shake your head and focus a little bit, it's clear that it's happening like as a vision in front of you. Like it's a little bit too clear to be like you're hallucinating or something. It seems like it's happening in a window kind of floating in front of you. You still see the screaming skin and the ritual and stuff, and eventually kind of like turns back into flames. And the kid puts his arm around you, your shoulders, and you hear him say, "Son, you're not supposed to be here. You know that, right?" And above the cigarette smell, you smell fire smell, you smell cigarette smoke as you turn to see the big man. And he's still big, but like his limbs are like more elongated, and it seems like his skull is pulled up and out a little bit, and he looks just like his face just looks tired. And he's just like, "What do you think you're doing?" And it's almost like the fire and screaming has kind of like the volume has been turned down on it.
"What do you think you're doing? We need to help these people."
"Can't help them. They're already here."
"Well, this kid belongs back home."
"Nah, he made his choice. You want to make this choice? I feel like there's bigger things in store for you."
"Well, what do you suggest? We can't just let this thing keep taking people here."
"Oh, it just likes it because of the pain."
"How do we stop it?"
Can I get what are you afraid? Like, what's the worst thing you think that he could tell you to stop it?
"You all need to die here."
Yeah, and I think that the worst than that is you don't die here, but you join the eternal time loop of immolation and screaming, which feeds the lurker more. Let's get another sensitivity roll for that.
Would this be counted under the Wandrick monolith at all? I guess we're not in the clue gathering
phase. Oh, right, yeah. Now. You know what? Let's add the clue stuff on top of that. Yeah, I think that's a great idea.
Sensitivity again. Say a little prayer. I'll take it.
An 8. Great. Yeah, cool. So the question was, how do we stop them? Or how do we stop it? Yeah, and he says, "A lot of strange things happen because of this. The universe gets thin. People like you show up where they're not supposed to. Not just you, right? Other things have found this spot. You're not going to be here for long. You don't have the grit for it. What you got to do if you want to stay is take a life and then bind what's left of it to this place. Find out where the binding site is. It's likely that it'll not be able to feed anymore. I mean, until it finds another way in anyway.
Find those kids." "Someone?"
"No, it had to kill someone."
"Okay."
"To get here. And it had to keep killing to stay. So find out what it killed. Take care of them. Should lose its grip."
"Thank you for the straightforward answer."
Oh, it's not all that straightforward, is it? And he just kind of turns into smoke, blows away. And I think you find yourself back in the hallway after that. And at this point, the clock has ticked back and the cycle has started again.
Okay, I grab everyone, pull up those guys, we need to find where the dead kids are. That's the only way to stop this.
Wait, what? We just have to leave these people in the gym?
They're already dead. We can't help them.
How do you know?
Big man told me.
Well, he said it. I mean, it's what happened? They're just going to relive the minute, the last 2 minutes? Or what are we going to do? I tried to get one guy out of there, and it didn't work. The best thing to do is try something else, at least for now. We can come back and save him on the 200th go-around if whatever else we try doesn't work.
Yeah, it's Groundhog Day this.
Okay, so where did he say we had to go?
Oh, and sorry, and from y'all's perspective, like David ran in, and you know, it was bad, and then when it snapped back, he just showed back up in the hallway.
Right.
Sorry, go ahead.
Not the weirdest thing to happen in the last couple minutes.
Okay, where did he say we have to go?
I mean, he wasn't that specific. It's still big, man. He just said...
Fucking course he wasn't. Okay, we should probably split up.
This thing, it's traveling through the pipes, right? That means it's probably back in the boiler room. Might have a nest there or something. Or the swimming pool. It likes water.
Boiler room, but the pool. Oh shit. Yeah. Yeah.
Well, we can split up. Oh, one team can go to the swimming pool, the other team can go back to the boiler room.
I thought I specifically said we should not split up when we came in here.
Michael, it's not one of your movies, okay? And even if one of us dies, we just respawn back at the prom.
As long as one of us doesn't run into a clawed hand burned man, we should be fine, right?
Look, I know we weren't supposed to split up, but new information has come to light, man.
Well, I'll go to the pool. I'm not going to the boiler room. I've seen enough Nightmare on Elm Street to know where that's going to go.
So is the minute resetting out here too? Or is it just in the gym?
It's hard to say because there's not really anything happening out here, but from like the people disappearing when they tried to exit, it feels like that phenomenon is isolated in the gym.
I'm going with David. I don't trust that. Look, I don't care what the big man told you. I'm going with you.
Yeah, I'll go with you, Michael. I don't really want to be in underground spaces. After what happened at Escondido House.
Okay. Okay, good.
Okay, let's go.
Okay, meet back here, I guess.
Yeah, like 20, 30 minutes.
If it takes that long, that's probably a problem.
Just go quick as you can before you get stuck here.
Cool. Who's going to the pool? Just Michael and Parker? Okay, great. So you, Erica and Sasha, and David know where the boiler room is. And so you're pretty easily able to trace your steps back there. And, it's pretty much as it was when you kind of popped in here. There's the furnace that is going. There's steam pipes that are dripping and leaking and stuff. And there's someone sitting in the corner. Shadow.
Kind of run up to them to kneel down, like, hey, are you okay?
It's a woman. She's in kind of a tracksuit, like exercise clothes. And she just kind of looks at you and shakes her head and then looks over your shoulder at David.
I immediately look back over my shoulder to see what's wrong with David.
David, when you approach the girl, as you know, you kind of enter the shadow that she's in, it's like she's in shadow and it's hard to tell, and then it's immediately clear to you, it's your sister.
Polly, what are you doing here?
Wait, Polly?
My sister, what the hell are you doing here?
Same thing you are. Waiting to die.
No, we're getting out of here. And I go to grab her on it.
Yeah, I'll help you pull her up.
Yeah, you pull her up and she's just like kind of loose feeling when you grab her. She's like, no. No one's getting out of here. I'm just gonna stay. And how are you grabbing her? Like by her
upper arm.
Yeah. As you're holding her upper arm, you feel it kind of like disjoint. It doesn't like pop out, but it feels like kind of like pulling apart a chicken that's been stewing for a while. It just kind of like comes off, and she just looks at you and says, "You're never leaving." And her skin starts kind of dripping off her face a little bit. Michael and Parker in the pool. it takes a few more minutes to find the pool, but it's not hard. It you can follow the smell of chlorine, and it is dark. Anyway, it is nighttime. There's kind of like the windows around the wall near the ceiling. And it's just dark out there, and the pool is a normal size, large school swimming pool, kind of lit from underneath, and even from the door, you can see that there are things in the pool. It's hard to say exactly what they are yet. What would you like to do?
I think Parker's gonna like cautiously walk up to the pool and kind of like gesture to Michael, like, "Do you see what that is?" But trying to be really quiet.
Yeah, and
yeah, he'll shimmy up there too.
Nice. And as you approach, it is very clear that they are people. And they are just kind of bobbing in the pool, and they're all just straight up and down. They're straight vertical up and down, and the tops of their heads are just like, it's just the tops of their heads that are bobbing above the water. And it's, you know, there's dozens of them just kind of floating in. Some look relatively okay. Some are, you know, almost skeletal at this point. And there was kind of floating just below the surface.
Is there any like that are near the edge of the pool?
Yeah. I think the ones in the center are the ones that are look like they've been there the longest. And as you kind of go around the edge of the pool, you start to like look for faces, and eventually you come across one that you're pretty sure is Emily. And she's just blue, eyes are open, just floating, just under the water.
Oh, okay. I'm gonna try to grab her.
Mm-hmm.
So you try to grab me in case something happens. How's that sound? Does that sound like a plan?
Yeah. Okay. We'll do that. Like, grab.
Yeah. 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 Arms. Exactly.
Yeah. Got it.
Perfect. And so, yeah, he'll kind of reach out.
What are you afraid might happen if, she is, if it is more dangerous than it looks on the surface, well, if she's not just like a person floating?
I think that Michael and Parker will join them in the pool.
Mm.
How is it worse than that, Mark?
I think it's worse than that, because you will join them in the pool. And when you do, you'll realize that they are dead, but they are still experiencing what's happening, even the ones that are skeletal. And you realize that you will be a deceased but conscious conduit for the lurker forever.
That sounds perfectly reasonable.
Yeah, totally good. Let's see. Let's have that be, you know what? Let's do sensitivity. I think that's makes the most sense here.
Yeah, I'll do that.
Unless so you want to go, I think vitality might be fine.
Vitality too, was what I was going to argue.
Okay, yeah. Let's do vitality.
Okay, I'll take the zero, I guess.
Yeah. And 11. Great. Yeah, so you are able to, she's, you know, it's not, there are a lot of them, and she is close to the edge. So you can like lean over. You're a little bit off balance, but Parker's got you. Where do you grab her? Do you just like grab the top of her head or try to grab an arm or shoulder or something?
I was thinking like, yeah, right under the arm and yeah, try to pull her towards me so I can get something more stable.
Yeah. And when you do, you feel there is a resistance. Kind of like if you've ever played with one of those like magnetic globes that kind of floats, when you try to pull it out of the magnetic field, there's some resistance there, but as you pull it away, the resistance lessens and you're able to get her to the side of the pool and plop her out. And you know, after just a moment of checking out, she is clearly dead. And it's, you know, you're not a forensic scientist or anything, but it's been a day or two.
Is there any like does the room shutter or anything cool like that when I pull her out, or should
not
I keep
yet
pulling people out?
Yeah, if you want to keep pulling people out, we can find out, but let's jump to the boiler room first. Yeah, so David, your sister is kind of just dissolving in your arms. How do you feel about that?
Not great. I think I realize, wait, this is the lurker. So I want to try and punch it in the face.
yeah. Your hand goes straight through the face. Like it's made it, like it is just like stew now. And you just got sister goop all over you and she finishes dissolving. And wow, this is going to be a condition, I think. Wow. Oh, let's have the condition, we are made of meat.
Okay.
Yeah. How is Erica reacting to that?
With a bit of a, I don't think she's that startled now that she David punching lurker Polly here. I think there's more of a, oh, that is fucking gross. Okay, clearly not the boiler room. Let's get out. We better go find the pool.
Yeah, and when you, as you turn to the stairs up, Michael and Parker run down, and they're just like, "We found the pool, and it's, you don't want to see it. It's, there's just body parts everywhere." And Parker's like, "Yeah, we should try going out the front door or something. I don't know. I think we're stuck here."
Wait, Parker, what the hell? Okay, so the pool didn't work, but we can't just leave. We have to find its lair.
No, it's too dangerous. I don't think we can. And Michael says, "Oh, just like you to run away from a problem or a unpleasant situation."
Okay, like both of you, just stop. You know what, Parker, if you need to go, that's okay. Go. David, Michael, come on, let's find the place. Let's finish this.
Yeah, and Parker's like, fine, and runs up the stairs, and you can hear her running down the hall. And after a moment, you just hear a scream, blood-curdling scream. And Michael says, you did that. You just killed her. You just killed them.
My static condition doing anything funny right now?
Oh yeah, I mean you're in it. you don't know this feels. I think maybe yeah. You know what? Since you're still kind of static, you do see that sort of pixelated edge around Michael. Now that you're like, what the fuck is going on?
I think I'm just like, hey, don't put that on Erica. That's not fair.
It's David. It's okay. That wasn't Parker. That's not Michael. We need to get to the pool. Come on.
Michael gives you a shove on the shoulder and is like, oh yeah, a lot of big talk. That's you with a big mouth all the time.
I'm going to grab David's hand and start running up the stairs to the pool.
Boyfriend's being kind of a jerk.
Michael has his other hand. He yanks him back down the stairs. He's very strong. And he just kind of throws David on the ground and says, you're going to pay for all the things you did. And just kind of towering over you. Real Michael and Parker back at the pool. tell me what you're doing again.
I don't know if Parker had any ideas, but I was thinking about fishing more people out if we can.
I want to see if there's like a way to drain the pool.
Ooh. You know what? I'm gonna make this a reason roll, I think. What are you afraid might happen if you find the machinery to drain the pool, but it does something else?
I'm afraid that it could start flooding the school.
Mm.
And making the lurker stronger in more places.
Ooh, yeah, I love that. Worse than that, you know, it floods the school. It, you know, since this is a weird space, it actually does like flood the entire school, and it's able to access the power. It floods the gymnasium while it's still on fire, and it's able to tap the power of these like eternally suffering people, which will probably not be a good time for anyone. This will be a sensitivity roll.
Cool.
And if you want to use an item or anything.
Can I think fondly of my Babysitter's Club books and use advantage?
Tell me
this
about
this happened in a Babysitter Club book, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah, it happens a lot of stories. I'm sure there's one that was at a gym or a pool. I do not remember any specific titles, but it's like, okay, I know how pools work. I'm going to use the Babysitter Club power for that.
Yeah, totally. That sounds right. Great. Yes, totally goes down.
Plus. And it's sensitivity, you said, right?
Yeah. So it'll be just, you have sensitivity of one.
Plus one.
So three dice, top two, plus one.
Okay.
That is a seven. That's a nine. Or that's a
eight.
Seven plus one. That's an eight. Great. Same deal. Great. Perfect. So you are able to find, you know, some pump machinery in the, you know, on the side. And after a little bit of fiddling, I think Michael actually, you have to like call Michael over to help and like, oh, you have to hold this and I have to turn this at the same time. But you hear an engine start up. And you see, you know, after a minute, it doesn't feel like anything is working, doing anything, but the level of the pool starts slowly going down.
You are a genius. You probably just saved my life because I was totally going in there.
Yeah, I honestly thought that might take too long to try to fish everyone out. And you also would have to touch a skeleton, which is gross.
I thought maybe it would do something.
And as it's there are doors, like double doors, like you came in through like a locker room or something, but there's also double doors. The doors just crash open and a car actually crashes halfway into the gym, and two people just like, one flies all the way out of the front and the other one has their head kind of embedded in the windshield. It's just like blood is dripping down. And the other one's just on the ground near the pool. What do you do?
Are we pretty deep in the, like, I feel like we're deep in the school, right?
Yeah, I think that the gym is like near a, it's like on the corner. So there's windows to the outside, and those double doors presumably go to the outside as well.
Okay, so it's not necessarily weird for a car to come flying.
Yeah, it's just weird timing.
Yeah. Are they moving at all?
You know, now that you mention it, the one that flew out all the way and was kind of like mangled a little bit on the ground, their head is, it looks like their neck is broken, but their head kind of looks up and looks right at Parker and says, "You think you killed us?"
I think Parker's going to start like shutting down, and they're going to start shaking and starting to like back away.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think Michael will like jump between Parker and the car.
Yeah, I think Parker's going to take a condition from this. I think it's just shut down. Yeah.
Yeah, kind of like catatonic.
Yeah. But the level in the pool is still going down. In the boiler room, Michael is standing over David on the ground, and it looks like he's just about to start, like, "Oh, you like punching people? Let's see how it goes." And he's going to give you some 1-2 for that. What are y'all doing there? Oh, but it looks like Erica, you notice that the static is a little bit more prominent now, just a little bit.
Yeah, Erica's right, you know, right in there, standing over David, ready, you know, fully ready to throw down here.
Mm-hmm. What are you afraid might happen if he's too strong for you?
That both David and I will be knocked out, and who knows if the others will find us, no matter, you know, with all the weird stuff going on here.
Yeah. Yeah, I think it's worse than that. He'll knock you out and throw you in the furnace. And yeah, that's not gonna, again, not gonna be a good time for anyone. This is definitely a vitality roll.
Let me take a look, see on that. I am definitely going to what Nintendo don't this one.
Excellent.
as David's there on the ground, a little bit stunned, I'm picturing you getting some bleeding, at least from your nose, because you've been smacked in the head a lot lately. So he, you know, he's clearly in a bad way. Eric is there standing over him, just making little fists balled up. And just snarls. Yeah, I got nothing tonight. I'm just going to do the, like, a Jean-Claude Van Damme roundhouse on this dude.
Nice. And it's kind of Scott Pilgrim-y. You probably practiced this and you're okay. But you'll actually like execute a like full on, like almost split, right, like you roundhouse his head clean off, and he just explodes into pixels. And both of you see this.
That was so cool.
I just drop down, drop down beside David to start helping up. That was really fucked up. Are you okay?
Are you hurt? I will be. Wait, I think I have an idea. Is there, I don't entirely sure how the boilers work, but is there like a central pipe we can knock down to stop this thing from circulating through the school?
Why do we want?
Yeah, I mean, you can probably find some pipes to take apart.
Let's start breaking down some of these pipes.
Yeah, I think, yeah, you're easily able to do that. And steam is everywhere. The room is just like a sauna now.
We need to get to the pool. Those things didn't want us to go up there. That means Parker and Michael are in trouble. We got to go. We got to go now.
I have a harder time about following us this way. So I think as I'm running, I'm just knocking down pipes.
Nice. Amazing. I love it. Cool. What's happening back at the pool? This body is starting to crawl towards, I guess, both of you now. And the one in the car is just kind of like rotating its head, and it looks like it's almost trying to like saw the top of its head off so it can get free. What do y'all do?
Yeah, I think that Michael is like between them, and he's got Parker by the shoulders. It's like, it's all right, you know where you are, not real. It just knows you, okay? And then if the thing gets kind of close enough to him, he'll just like stomp it.
Mm-hmm.
If the body is crawling towards him, does see yeah. No problem.
Yeah, I think you can stomp it away. Definitely, like if you like give it a good stomp, like it will, the head will split open some. But after a moment, it'll like start pulling its way towards you again. And I think this is about the time when David and Erica show up. David and Erica, the pool is, I don't know, a quarter of the way drained. There are a bunch of bodies floating, stuck upright in it. Some of them are standing on the bottom now, kind of like with the tops of their faces exposed. And there is a car that has crashed through the window with dead bodies that are slowly making their way towards Michael and Parker.
Say that Erica snagged a pipe wrench while we were down in the boiler room.
Nice.
Yep. Just gonna run in there and start going all zombie film on these.
Nice. Yeah, and I don't think that's even a roll. You can turn these things into mush, and they're not going anywhere. Parker, you still hear them, even though they're just like a pile of ground meat at this point, oozing all over the place. You can still hear that voice saying, like, you're going to pay for what you did to us.
Yeah, I feel like Parker keeps muttering, like, is this what I forgot? I don't remember. I must have done this, like stuff like that.
Are there still zombies coming?
No.
Corpses.
Yeah. You smash them. They're kind of, they're still like twitching, and but they're not able. You've broken every part that's able to locomote, move.
Yeah. I'll drop down to her knees, you know, just kind of on the other side of Parker, and join in, kind of holding on to him. Like, what's wrong with Parker?
Well, you know, I think it has to do with it knowing the inside of our heads. So it's telling him that this is what happened all those years ago. These are the people.
David, how's the pool doing?
It's like 75% of the way there.
Do you think
and like, these are the bodies. These are its either favorite or something. This is it. We are in the right spot.
Yeah, this is as far as you tell, this is probably everyone that's ever gotten.
Hey.
And then I'll point over to the one I pulled out. Unless yeah, it's
definitely,
gone.
Definitely Emily.
Not there anymore.
Yeah. No, yeah, she's still there.
It's definitely Emily.
Yeah.
That's what I thought. I'll just kind of just keep like rubbing Parker's back, just kind of whispering, like, okay, Parker, like, hang on, we'll get you out here soon. You just need to stay a bit longer. I'm sorry.
Yeah, and I think Parker's like, my friends are with me. It's okay. We got to defeat this. We're going home. And just like trying to make a new mantra, but that isn't this voice speaking to them.
Mm-hmm. Has everyone seen the big man at this point?
I think we saw it on the TV.
Yeah, he was on the tape.
Yeah.
But Parker hasn't seen them like in real life, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
I think Parker's the only one who hasn't seen him in person. Yeah.
Yeah. I think one of the bodies in the pool starts it's on the far side, climbs out of the pool, kind of shakes itself off, and just puts on a big cowboy hat. Only Michael, Erica, and Sasha, or David, see this. Parker, you don't see anything. And he kind of like cracks his neck a little bit, and he looks like he did when David, when you first met him, still full and kind of like in charge of stuff. And he looks you right in the eye, and you know, from his soggy vest inside his coat, takes out a pack of cigarettes and lights one up, puts in his mouth, even though it doesn't seem like a cigarette that's been in a pool for a while would be able to light, and just starts like keeping eye contact with you, slowly walking around the pool, coming around to you.
I see you gained the weight back.
And he doesn't say anything.
Okay, thanks. Is there a pool, like a pool nearby?
Yeah, yeah, one of the like rescue poles.
Want to grab it and smash it through this thing's face?
Yeah. He just like almost casually just like puts his hand up and grabs it and kind of like whistles as he kind of like pulls it a little bit, and as he walks closer to you.
All right, I want to let it go, run, and tackle this thing.
All right. What are you afraid might happen if this big man like is an immovable object for your tackle?
I'm afraid it's going to absorb me into its folds.
Oh, I love it. Worse than that, huh? Yeah, I think it doesn't just absorb you, but you kind of become it. Like you, you know, you join the collective or whoever that is, this big man, and you're able to see through his eyes, not necessarily able to control him.
All right.
And this man, this is vitality. Yeah.
Yeah, I agree with that.
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. You charge him, and like when you start, he almost like casually like leans down as if he's gonna tie his shoe. But when you get by, he just comes up with an uppercut, is like twisting, and just like sends you like up 15 feet in the air, and then, you know, crashing against the wall, and you are just broken. You're still conscious, but like must have broken your neck or something. You can't move. And he picks up the pole and starts whistling again, and comes over to finish the job. Would you like to turn a key?
I would like to mark the chromatic desert.
Ooh. Oh, all right.
Oh shit. Okay.
Nice. Fantastic. So now you can no longer be perceived by the other characters, and all memory of you is erased. It's like you never existed. You can continue to conduct investigations, but the clues you find are only available if you narrate them into an Odyssey tape scene. Whew.
Wow.
That's one of my favorite keys, by the way.
That is amazing. Yeah, so no more conditions for you there. But ooh, I think what happens, and Parker, you still don't see this big man. But as Erica and Michael see David charging the big man, something happens just before he reaches him. His limbs elongate, his clothes turn yellow, and he you know, grabs him around the middle and kind of like body slams him down. And when he stands up, he is the big man. Like you probably haven't seen him before. And Parker, you see this one now. His, you know, his limbs are longer, his face is gaunt, and he just looks depressed. And he, you know, the other one's starting to get up, and he like turns and looks at y'all and just brings his cowboy boot down on its head, splitting it open. And when he does, it pixels out just like the fake Michael did. And the big man looks at Parker, and this is the first time you've seen him in person. What about him kind of snaps you out of your thing?
I think Parker's remembering seeing him on the TV and being like, this guy has answers. This is the truth somewhere in here. Mm-hmm. And that is like, okay, the past doesn't matter. What's happening right now matters. And so it snaps back.
Cool. And he straightens his hat and he kind of looks at you as if he heard what you were thinking. He says, you're damn right. So what are you waiting for? Get in the pool.
So I think Parker's going to walk towards the pool.
And it's about half full at this point.
Yeah, so not jump in, but just like, you know, that little stair step part and just start walking into the pool. Mm-hmm.
Can the rest of us see and hear this?
Oh yeah, yeah, this is happening.
Oh yeah, Michael's not going to let you go over there.
No, we're, yeah.
If I can suggest, Parker, this might be a good time for your move.
Okay, yeah. Yeah, so, okay.
You're pretending to listen to him, right?
Yeah. Guys, help me come up with something.
I mean, so, honestly, if you want to use your move, the best thing to do is just follow his instructions.
Okay.
And you feel like a sense of like peace and just like, oh, like
brightness.
Yeah, like he's not fucking with us. He's like, you got about half a pool's worth of time left to get out of here.
Yeah. Okay. So I think Parker's like, no, like, guys, this is for real. You have to trust me. And like holds out both of their hands. This is our way out.
Well. And if you say so, I'll go along with it. If you think that's right, you saved me a minute ago. So,
okay, let's get out of here.
And as you walk into the pool, you know, it is more than half drained now, but as you walk into the water, it feels like you can still, like, as if the water is deeper than it looks, and you can walk in until you're completely submerged. And you feel a kind of a tightness around your middle. And as you go under the water, it becomes dark, and you feel like you can't breathe. It feels like you've breathed in a lot of water, and you kind of struggle a bit. After, like, it feels like you're going to go out again, and that's when you break the surface of the lake and just like spit all that water out of your lungs, and you're just you feel a weight below you. The rope is still tied to your waist.
Roll call, is everyone okay? Like, and I think Parker's trying to like splash around.
Yeah, if you pull the rope, Erica and then Michael will come up next to you. Same deal. You guys, it goes dark. It feels like you're drowning, and you break the surface, and you find that you can breathe again.
Is there only three of us?
Yeah.
I guess I wouldn't remember that there's a fourth, would I?
Nope.
Yeah. We're all here. The gang's all here, yeah. Everybody.
Yeah.
Us and our extra length of rope.
Yeah. And not only is the gang all here, but as you look around, you see that there are dozens of bodies floating in the lake. Or some are floating. Some may not be able to float anymore. But like, as you know, as you come up and kind of get your bearings, they sort of like pop up to the surface one at a time in various states of decomposition.
I just look over the water at this incredibly horrific sight and say, I think I should call Bill.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
And then Michael will start paddling. Is our
boat still here? It's probably nearby. Yeah.
You can swim over to it. And then he's like, you know, I used to like this place when I was a kid.
I don't think the lake was filled with dead bodies like this when we were kids. Or was it? I don't know.
I don't know. That's the problem. Yeah. I swam in here when I was like 12 years old.
Yeah. I learned to swim in here when I was like 12 years old. So,
guess I didn't miss much by never going to camp.
Well, at least you're here now.
Yeah. And you can make it to shore. Call Bill. It is late. It is like 4 in the morning. And he just kind of groggily is like, Erica, what do you want?
Right, because he and I didn't talk after she was...
No, you just fucked off.
Yeah. Bill, I'm sorry. I know it's really late. Parker told me that he told you what was going on. He said you believe me. And look, you know that urban legend up at the camp?
Yeah. The monster, the deep lake monster.
It's not a legend. We took care of it, and you need to come out here with a recovery team.
But you set the lake on fire.
Bill, please. There's a lot of bodies.
And he just goes silent for a minute. And after like a little bit too long of a pause, he's... I'll be right down. Yeah, I think the kind of epilogue of the night is a couple of cop cars, lights flashing, you know, police tape all over the place, and just rows and rows of bodies with sheets over them on the shore. And like campers and counselors and people who just heard about it, kind of at the edge of the police line trying to like get a look and take pictures and stuff. And Bill is just like, I don't know where these... I don't know how you... Thanks. I think you put a lot of people's mind to rest. Whatever you did, I don't think I want to know.
No, you don't. At least you know I just haven't been fucking with you.
I hope not.
Let's go home.
You're a really... either that or you're a really prolific serial killer.
Wow, you just come on guys, let's go home.
Nice. Cool. Yeah. Let's do our dawn real quick. Awesome. A threat was resolved. Yeah, you found the bodies. May not have actually stopped the lurker itself, but you definitely resolved the mystery there. Done. So that means we get some rewards. Hooray. Rewards. So rewards for this mystery. Cool. So here are the things that you can choose from. Everybody gets one, including David. One reward is a conversation with either Harvey or Mary Stowski on Deep Lake's banks, where you tell a story about your time at Pine Ridge Rock. unmark a key of the child you have already answered. This reward is only available to a latchkey that has a condition, the next victims, which you still have because the it was not cleared. The next reward is Emily Beaumont becomes a recurring side character. You get an extra clue on the meddling move when you consult her about matters related to Deep Lake's natural environments. A Pine Rock Ridge branded multi-tool added to your corner of the house. A lifeguard whistle added to your corner of the house. Or a memento from the investigation. Ask another latchkey what it is and add it to your corner of the house. What do we feel like?
If nobody has dibs on the whistle, I will definitely take the whistle.
Get it.
I think I'll take Emily as a resource.
Cool.
And where do you mark that? Or
yes.
Do I just take note of that?
Yeah, put it in the notes on your character at the bottom. Okay. Where are we there? That is, or you can put it down to the in your corner of the house and we just know it isn't, but notes is probably the best place for it. Interesting choice. Excellent.
So please repeat what the conversation was.
Yeah, so you'll have a conversation with basically the Stowski's parents, who you found the body of, what was her name? Jessica Stowski. They were probably there when the bodies came up. And so you have a conversation with them and you'll be able to unmark a key of the child that you've already used. But that one's only for the next victim. So that would be a David one.
Right. Thank you. I'll take the multi-tool.
Excellent. David, unmark a key or get a different memento from the investigation?
I should unmark a key because I'm running out of those quick.
Fantastic. And I think what that looks like is, you know what? I'm going to alter it a little bit.
Yep.
And it's going to be a conversation with Jessica instead.
Ooh.
What does it look like when you're on the edge of the lake?
I think I'm standing in front of it, but like again, when we went over the first time, the entire surface of the lake is just like staticky TV images.
Yeah.
The whole thing stretching as far as the eye can see. And otherwise, things appear normal, but again, like you said earlier, the stars aren't quite right up in the sky.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And Jessica stands up. But it's kind of like the ghost stand up, you know, when like she stands up, but her body is still there covered by the sheet. And she kind of walks over to you and just stands next to you, looking out at the static lake. And you know, just sort of like having a conversation with you both looking out. And she says, you didn't have to do that.
Oh, it felt like the right thing to do at the time. Sorry we couldn't help you.
I mean, you don't know what it was like. I appreciate it.
I guess it wasn't total waste.
You did a lot of good for a lot of people. You'll probably never know exactly what, but.
What happens now?
Now we're free. It doesn't seem like you are, though.
What do you mean?
I mean, you're not like us. You still got things to do here.
Well, remember that summer at camp? It's pretty fun, wasn't it?
Yeah. Do you have a story to tell her about your time at Pine Ridge Rock? Again?
I think it was one I did about having a birthday with my sister there.
Mm.
I think upon remembering it more, it wasn't just us. Jessica was there too.
Mm. Nice. Cool. Yeah. And she, says, again, she looks over to you and says, thanks. And just kind of fades away. Cool. Yeah. Unmark your key. Answer our Dawn questions and turn those into XP. You definitely resolved the mystery. So that's at least one point. If you feel like you got a signal from the other side, getting an echo from something in the last Odyssey tape, mark that one off. And answer your other questions, turn those into XP. And if you advance, let me know what we're looking at. Yeah, I think we'll take a little break here and come back in the morning. I'll take, let's do 10. All right. Whew. Okay. That happened. Cool. Let's hit daytime then. Day. Cool. So just to review the two other current mysteries going, we still have Greetings Travelers active. Answered the complexity 6 question, where are the flyers luring kids? In the sewers leading to a missing silo, and that can be resolved by locating the current location of the underground game and convincing the would-be gamers to give it up. There's also the Whisper that has the open question, is the Whisper a supernatural infestation or a man-made experience? That's a complexity 4, and it will unlock the next question. And you got some clues there. All right. And we will have a new mystery as the day starts. What do y'all do in the morning after that harrowing experience?
Erica's, gonna do like usual, wake up and come downstairs, go for the coffee maker, and just have the sense of, weird, I thought don't the other guys normally make a pot in the morning when it's usually there when I get up? Okay, fine. Starts making coffee, rummaging through for looking for the filters and everything. And as she's, kind of going through the pantries, getting out the grinder on the counter, hand brushes against, some clutter there, and there's a Zippo, and again looks at it like, not mine, the other guys don't smoke. Whatever. And starts making coffee.
I think Parker gets up whenever they smell the coffee. And it's like, all right, comes down and the same sort of like weird, like, oh, okay, just one person drinking coffee, okay. And I feel like whenever they start making breakfast, it's like, all right, 8 eggs. And then it's like, wait, no, 6 eggs. Huh, okay. And just like, I'm still sleepy, and starts making breakfast. And so maybe there are those little like nudges of something's.
Yeah, I think Michael is asleep on the couch in the living room. He never like went to his room. And the only thing they're playing is Twin Peaks. He fell asleep watching Twin Peaks.
Nice.
Need a hand, Parker?
Do you want to set the table? These omelets are almost done.
Sure. Yeah, it smells great. Don't you normally make more? I'm sorry, I didn't mean it. It's like that.
Are you hungry? I can make another one.
No, it's cool. It was a weird night. We're all running on not much sleep.
Sure, you can also get like the juice, and don't forget to open a window. Maybe David always like smokes first thing and is like, okay, get the smell out of the kitchen, we're eating. And Parker always complains about that.
She goes over, finishes saying the table, cracks open the window. Fresh air would probably do you good after that tonight. You okay? I mean, no, but like, do you want to talk about it?
Not right now, I guess. It's just still trying to process that wasn't real. And everyone's, I guess, safe.
I guess so. I mean, we did it, right? Like, we solved the mystery. We got closure for all those parents. That's, like, we did good.
Yeah, we did. We did good. But, maybe we should do something fun today. I don't know. Go out into town. Michael, can you think of any ideas?
Michael's totally asleep.
Sorry if you were going somewhere.
Oh, no, you're totally fine. Yeah, I think Michael's actually still asleep on the couch.
Oh, okay. I wasn't sure if you had woken up with the smell of coffee and tube.
I think he stayed up really late watching Twin Peaks. Super. I mean, it was, what, 5 by the time we got back? He probably went to bed at like 8 or 9.
Erica looks over with a, you know, just like a sad smile and just says, I might need to sleep in today, but we could, I mean, like, we could go out, you know, if he doesn't wake up before then. Going out sounds fun. I don't know. I don't care where we go as long as we don't run into Belle.
Yeah, he's being jerky to you yesterday. Maybe he doesn't like being woken up in the middle of the night or something. I'm sure it wasn't about you.
Had nothing to do with like 20 bodies popping up out of nowhere.
Yeah, all that paperwork. Cops love paperwork.
Oh, Parker, come on. Like, it's not like, I'm, yeah, of course that was weird and awful and no one likes that, but he was a dick before he arrested me, and then when he arrested me, and then after, and he told me he liked me, whatever. Anyways, let's go out. Let's make sure, you know, make sure at least Michael gets some coffee. Okay, there's no good way to say for this to sound good, but don't take it like this. Do you know what's a good place in town to avoid the cops?
No. Where?
Yeah. Whatever. Let's. I don't know. I'm. That's just.
Do you want to go to the mall?
Out of character, I want to pursue the whisper question today. So the mall could be a really fun place to figure out if the whisper is a supernatural infestation or a man-made experiment.
Interesting.
Michael, are you going to wake up and come with us?
Yeah, sure. I'll do that. That's fine. Or you can wake me up. Just shake him a little bit. I'm sure he'll wake up.
Yeah, I think after after Parker and Erica have both finished their breakfast, you know, just go and give a little shake.
Yeah.
Hold out a cup of coffee.
Cool.
Yeah, he'll kind of get up, wiping his eyes. Ugh, jeez.
Michael, did you check your message boards and stuff last night before you went to sleep too? Or were you kind of fiddling on them while you're watching?
Yeah. I think he would, cool. Especially after that, probably.
Yeah. Cool. So I'll do the question first and then do the presenting. So one of the forums you're active on is the Vector Void forum. It's a video game forum. And lately a user named ATAPHOI85 has been posting cryptic and hostile messages on any threads that are discussing this old video game, Zagreus. What harrowing message have you personally received from ATAPHOI85, suggesting that they aren't just some troll and may actually be a threat to your safety?
I think that he gave me the classic toxic gamer response where he sent me a message with the address that Michael's staying at.
Ooh, nice. Cool. And kind of after this behavior, you recall some stuff about this game and some stuff around it. So in the summer of 1985, five teenagers went missing from Deep Lake. Hutch Langley, Dieter Hoskins, Finn Carlson, Rachel Arrieta, and Monique Jeffries. Prior to their disappearance, they frequented the Galaxia arcade, playing games all day long. One day they just stopped, and when school started back up, they were noticeably somber, even morose, and they all had a newfound obsession with death. The last picture taken of them before they vanished was featured in the school's yearbook. Showed the five teens sitting along the edge of the highway wearing t-shirts that had the Styx Society badly silkscreened on them. To this day, nobody knows what happened to them, and their families have long since left the desert behind in search of a fresh start. 3 years ago, on Vector Void, the forum exploded with activity over a thread entitled, Does Anyone Remember Zagreus? The game that Atefoy 85 sent you threatening messages about. The original poster asked about an arcade game they vaguely remembered hearing of in the 80s, but hadn't been able to find anything about. And then several users responded to that, each claiming to know details of this mysteriously niche game. Nothing was really concrete, however, until a user named Sinkerly308 posted that Zagreus was developed by a company called Vertex Electronica, which closed in 1999. The user claimed to have interned there while the game was in development, though he hadn't worked on it himself. Additionally, they said the game has secret levels that can only be accessed via unusual methods, though they did not indicate what those were. Other users connected the location of Vertex Electronica's old office, which is in Deep Lake, New Mexico, with stories of the Styx Society and their disappearance. An urban legend about a cursed arcade cabinet was born. When you play the game, you disappear. And on the forums, you discover that a Zagreus cabinet was found 1 week ago. Ephraim Goldman, who is the owner of the Galaxia Arcade, discovered in a lot auction at the Me Plus My self-storage facility on the outskirts of town, immediately recognizing the popularity of its surrounding legend. He had it installed at the shop and advertised its existence on the message board, Vector Void. Enthusiasts have started to travel from all over the country to play it. What the hell? Maybe you can see if it's worth the hype. So that is our new mystery. The mystery is Zagreus. And there are several questions. The first question is, who is Atefoy 85 and why are they doing this? That's a complexity 4, and that will let you remove them as a danger from this mystery by unmasking them and convincing them to let it go or neutralizing them. There's a complexity 2, that's just how do you access Zagreus's secret levels, and that unlocks a new move, press start. And then there's one that's complexity 6, which is locked until you complete the secret levels using press start. Cool. So Michael has all that information, and I assume we'll share with the rest of the folks as the day progresses.
Oh, this game sounds kind of creepy. Can we just play The Last Starfighter instead?
No. Yeah, but it's the creepy thing that that makes it, you know? People have been talking about this forever.
I imagine. I'm like picturing, you know, the time to go in the morning. We'll need Erica's car because it's got the full, the full 5 seats or 4.5 or whatever you want to call it. Get in, losers, we're going to the mall. Yeah, I'm just imagining these talking the whole time, and Erica and Parker are just, still in the half asleep,
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they're in the front seats, and he's in the middle back seat with his arms up on the rest, and he's like, yeah, so the last time I read about the, and then he just talks the entire time.
Nice. So where are you headed? The mall?
The mall. We're good losers. Oh. We are going to the mall.
What is the name of the mall in Deep Lake?
Yeah, I don't know. You guys know about American names. I know something Vista. It's New Mexico. I don't know. When I'm GMing and people ask for a name, I just say it's Steve. I don't think we can call them all Steve. Help me out here, guys.
I'm at a loss right now. I'll be the one that says it out loud. I got nothing.
We'll just go with Deep Lake Mall then.
That's what I was thinking.
Yeah, that's great. Yeah, that totally works. Cool. So you've all been to the mall when you lived here as younger folks. Let's just do a paint the scene for the mall, and that's just going to be what's your favorite store that you used to go to, and how has it changed now? And David can answer this too.
Probably Selman's, which was a tailor specializing in bespoke suits.
How is it different now?
I think Selman has been replaced by his son, Selman the Younger, whose work is not nearly as, you know, refined as his father's. Nice.
I mean, how about there's an arcade in the mall that Michael used to go to all the time.
Cool. Yeah, I think that's the Galaxia Arcade, we'll call that. Yeah. Well, let me double check to make sure there's nothing about it that.
Yeah, if it doesn't contradict anything. It.
Yeah. Yeah, it could be at the mall. Yeah. Galaxia Arcade is at the mall.
Yeah, and how is it different? Of course, they have those new shit games. They don't have the great old ones that that used to be there.
Yep. They're all racing games and fighting games.
Yeah. They got, what is it? Street Fighter? They got Street Fighter there.
Can't believe they got rid of the Crisis Cabinet. Erica's favorite store is Sunrise Records, the music shop, to get your, the way it's changed is that, well, there's still cassettes, but there's a lot less of them. You know, it's almost all CDs now.
Mm-hmm.
Hardly any vinyl. You know, no one listens to that except old people. And other than that, they took away the listening stations. You know, they used to have where you bring a CD up to the counter and asked to get a little preview on the headsets. You could stand there and listen to it. And since last time she was here, the listening stations are gone. So now you just kind of have to, it's a lot harder to browse now. It's not very friendly.
I think Parker used to go to Cold Affairs, which was a golf and golf shop. Thank you for getting my joke, which is a goth shop, and now it's all marketed towards cartoon characters, and it's now well lit, and is not the same Cold Affairs that they used to go to.
Fantastic. Cool. So where do y'all head off first? Oh, and David, are you going to the mall with them, or are you going to go investigate something else?
Sure, I'll tag along to the mall.
Excellent. So where are we going
next? Michael's going to the arcade. After did all that ranting, he definitely has to go there, I think.
Excellent.
I mean, get a catch a couple of games, sure, why not? And yeah. I mean, it's probably the least likely place to run into the cops. I sure hope we don't. Wink.
That's true.
Bill's playing House of the Dead.
It's probably got a lot of paperwork to do right now, so you're probably safe for a little bit. So Galaxy Arcade, there's a line out the door. It's too many people. It's not a huge place. And so it looks like people, and a lot of people from out of town, are waiting to get in. Like they're doing a one in, one out thing now. But it still smells like dust, kind of like sweat, cheap pizza. And it's a little bit warm in there. The AC is not great, and there's a lot of bodies packed in there. It just got that pervasive noise of all the games going. Also paint the scene. This was the place to be for any tween or teen in late 1980s Deep Lake. What's your favorite memory from the Galaxia Arcade, and what still persists into the present day that reminds you of it?
I think that when Michael was here last, it was like a big boom in fighting game stuff. And so what they do is two people would play, and there would be people on deck. And what they'd do is they'd come up and they'd put their quarter at the corner of the screen. And that would indicate that they're on next to whoever wins stays. And I think his favorite memory is like being on the cabinet for a couple hours, just winning over and over again.
Nice.
I think David was kind of like, obsessively into trying to win the claw machine. Just so he would miss and just like feed it quarters while his sister played like the actual games. And I think one day he got like a good prize and gave it to her as a gift.
Nice.
And I think just passing by, he sees like the same kind of little stuffed animal in the pot.
Nice.
When Erica was, a tween, her and her friend Maria, who was the one who used to go to the camp, they liked to come to the arcade, and they weren't big into the fighting games or the racing games back then. They would come and spend hours playing the Simpsons arcade game. And there was, they constantly get, hung up on different levels here and there, but eventually, after kind of a few months of coming back on Saturdays, they beat it. So of course they played again, because you got to beat the high score, right? They didn't even come close that first time. The Simpsons arcade cabinet is long gone, but it's been replaced by a Dance Dance Revolution machine. And nice. That gives Erica a little twinge as she walks past, because before Erica left Deep Lake, Maria went her own way. She said she was going to Juilliard to train and dance. Don't know if she ever did, but she always did like to dance, and she would have liked that machine.
Nice.
I'm so sorry. What was the question?
What's your favorite memory from the Galaxia Arcade, and what still persists into the present day that reminds you of it?
I think that when Parker was 10 or 11, they got invited to like a birthday party at the arcade, and they were trying to impress their friend. And that was the only time that they got the middle shot of the skee ball three times in a row. And so they were able to win like the most tickets, and they were the coolest kid at the birthday party. Nice. And so I think that now at the arcade, they don't have the tickets anymore. They probably just have that little pay card. Mm-hmm. And so they're kind of sad about that. They remember that day fond.
Nice. Cool. So tell me what you're gonna do there. You're eventually able to get in. You have to wait in line a little bit. There's a guy in front of you in line who you know, is kind of like talking nonstop about this game. And when inevitably the person in front of him gets in, he turns around to you. And you know, he's got like, you know, like Coke bottle glasses. He's got a "All Your Base Belong to Us" t-shirt. He's got like a Legend of Zelda, you know, like visor. And he just turns. Who's standing in front?
I can be standing in front.
Yeah. So he just turns to Parker and he's like, "Yeah, man. You know what? Like I was saying, I don't know if you heard, but you know, are you here to play Zagreus? Or I came from Billings. This place is wild. It's so hot and dry here. I don't know how y'all manage it. But it makes sense that it would be here, right? Because of the right."
And I think Parker is just looking very confusedly and like looks at the other two and is like, I'm sorry, man. I don't know what you're talking about. What does that mean?
You know, the aliens, right? You're not supposed to say it out loud, I guess.
The aliens.
You ever see any out? Oh yeah,
that sort of stuff.
People say those kids disappeared because of like ghosts or whatever, but there's no such thing as ghosts, right? But it makes sense down here. You know, they're trying to make first contact with us through, you know, our most sophisticated form of entertainment, right? Just trying to like figure out who is the chosen and, you know, make contact with them, right? I haven't played before, but I'm going to give it a shot and fingers crossed.
So you want to be abducted by aliens because of this game?
Oh yeah. Yeah. Wouldn't you? I mean, think about it. If you were, you know, in space on your spaceship, and looking down at all of humanity, who would you want to take? You'd want to take the best and brightest, the ones who are most determined and focused and driven, goal-oriented. And you know what? Those people finish games. So yeah, what kind of utopian society would they take me to? I don't know, but it would be rad, man.
From behind Parker, you know, short little Tyler Lyrica just kind of pipes up half in behind Parker. Kid, you've seen The Last Starfighter way too many times.
Yeah, right? Just like that. It would be amazing. Just pew, 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 pew.
Yeah, that was, you know, that's not like a documentary, right?
Yeah, but it's aspirational.
I love the idea that Erica turns around to give Michael like the get a load of this guy, and Michael's totally fucking into this guy's story. He loves it. Yeah, man, he kind of has a point a little bit.
Yeah, though. You know what I'm talking about, man, right?
I know what you're talking about.
Not you.
No, I mean, I don't really like The Last Starfighter, but I mean, look at him. He's dressed to impress.
Yeah, I'm ready to go anytime, anywhere.
I'm sorry, like, you don't like
The Last wristbands Starfighter. On.
You don't like The Last Starfighter, and you think that Zagreus is a way to contact aliens?
Okay, I don't know about contacting aliens with the game. But if they are going to take people, they would definitely take people with that kind of drive, you know?
Yeah, I mean, you're not going to contact them, but they're going to contact you.
Erica just is doing the, you know, pinch of the bridge of the nose.
This is where Michael gets broken up with instantly after like 2 days.
Oh. How much longer are we going to have to wait in line anyways?
Oh, yeah, my turn. Time to go. You're up next. And he's like an old older gentleman who you probably know as the owner, Ephraim. Kind of like a couple people come out and he lets him in. And he's like, yeah, your turn's coming soon. And goes back in.
Man, this place, I didn't even think that the forum would be anywhere close to doing it justice, but I didn't think it'd be this packed.
Do you think they're all in there to play that game that you were talking about?
I saw people talking online that people were coming from all over the place. So what did that guy say? He was from like Montana or something like that. I don't know. I heard about people coming from farther away, but I thought they were full of shit.
Yes, they kept coming after all. And at this point, Erica relents a little. You know, gives a little. You know, just smiles a bit and says, "Like, really into this game, huh?"
I mean, so nobody's figured out how to do the secret level stuff, but that's what I'm interested in. There's this big, this person that said they had these secret levels, but they never said how to do it. Nobody's been able to access it. Nobody's even been able to play the game until recently when it popped up out of nowhere. I mean, this guy's doing gangbusters with business now. I mean, look at this place.
I think it's about then when Ephraim, FG, it's like, okay, you three, and other people are like, you three are together, right?
Yeah, the three of us.
Come on in, man. You're here to play Zagreus? This guy looks like the type.
I'm going to try.
Yeah, and he ushers you in. David, how are you interacting with the arcade here?
I just ignore the line, walk through, just kind of wandering down the lanes of games. Until I get to Zagreus, I just want to stare at it from behind the shoulder of whoever's currently playing it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. the game itself is interesting. It's, you know, the it's I just found it here. Just a second. You know, the arcade art on the side kind of has like heroes fighting stuff and like shadowy things with red eyes coming out of a cave and stuff, but it's rarely indicative of what you actually see on the screen. It looks like it's about a little pixelated guy, kind of like around Mortal Kombat ish level, maybe a lot less, and he's kind of, you know, trying to find his way out through, looks like he's going through caves and fighting demons and stuff. It looks pretty simple, but people don't seem not to last long. It like is deceptively simple, but then suddenly, like, you know, a god of flame will come out of the ground and someone will, you know, die and like, ah, man, someone else will take their place. Are you looking for anything in particular there?
I want to look at the person playing it and see if the experiencing this is there anything weird to them.
Ooh. It sounds like a metal investigation. What do you feel like this would be with?
Sensitivity?
Yeah, let's go with sensitivity. I like that.
Seven.
Great. Yeah. And I think you overheard them talking about the stuff about putting coins on the cabinet for who plays next. But as you're kind of like looking around at the person, when they lose, looks like a little drains out of them, right? And they're like a little dejected and, you know, kind of walk around and just sit on the ground next to the machine, like up against the wall. And as you go, like kind of like follow them to see, you know, what they look like, how they're doing, the cabinet is a little bit further out from the wall than some of the other games. Maybe like the cord is in a weird place or something. They had to get it. And you notice something weird about the machine back there. And when you stick your head back, it looks just like scratches from handling. It's an old game. It's like 20 years old, 30 years old, 20-ish, I guess. So it's had some handling, but it looks like there are scratches that look like about, like if someone with long fingernails, a human, was almost like they're trying to get out or get in. It's hard to tell. Again, you kind of like brush it off. It must be some kind of, just regular wear from moving around. And you know something that looks like a wood chip sticking out of the back. You just go to grab it, pull it off the back. And it's actually a fingernail. So that is a clue. And so, again, the way you can still get clues, the clues you find are only available if you narrate them into an Odyssey tape scene.
Okay.
So
on the character keeper to denote.
I'm going to put it on in the clues list. I'm going to gray it out a little bit. I'll just like...
And is the space behind the cabinet enough for someone to crawl through?
It's like 9 inches away from the wall. So someone probably could crawl back through there. You're not entirely sure how you fit back there, actually, but you did. Cool. Sorry about that. Awesome. And we can roll that back if that's too much.
I'd rather it not be a clue we wind up having to talk about. Yeah.
Okay, yeah. What if it's a cat's claw that came out?
Cat's claw, or even like one of those fake acrylic fingernails.
Oh yeah, acrylic fingernail, yeah. Acrylic fingernail. Perfect. Thank you. Great. Yeah. So it's clearly a fake fingernail. It's, when you pick it off, it's plasticky and it's painted and it has like a little jewel on it or whatever. It was still like embedded in the wood. Thank you for calling that out. Awesome. I think you all, you're in the arcade. You will be able to step up to the game itself if you want to, or you can just poke around and see what else is there. What do you feel like doing?
I don't think Parker's really interested in playing the game, but seeing everyone into it, is the owner around, like the person who bought the
arcade? Yeah, he's the guy that let you in. You probably, if you've been there before, you probably recognize him. He's been there the entire time. This is just like his jam. And he's very enthusiastic about, he'll like talk your ear off about the new thing if you want to track him down.
Yeah, that's what I'd like to do.
Yeah, his name's Ephraim Goldman. Okay. And, he's like a old, not hippie, but kind of the same. He's got long, long white hair, kind of like a long mustache and beard. He's not kind of wrinkly, but still sparkling a little bit. He's got one of those coin changers on his belt. He's been here, since the 70s. he's just like super psyched. What do you want to talk to him about?
I think Parker's going to go up and be like, hey, Ephraim, you probably don't remember me, but it's good to see you.
Welcome back.
Looks like business is doing awesome.
Can you believe it? I've yeah, I thought this was going to be a hoot, but never anything like this.
Yeah, it's great to see that it's doing so well.
Yeah.
So where'd you find this game anyway? It looks like it's a real like hit with everyone.
Yeah, I'm surprised. I mean, we had one way back, in the 80s or whatever, but even before like the whole thing happened, like nobody really wanted to play this. Now it's a novelty, and I guess no one else wanted it. I picked it up at one of those lot auctions, like an auction of a storage space down at me and myself. You know where that is?
Yeah.
On the edge of town there.
Yeah.
Well, it's a fun hobby. Yeah, you go there and there's usually nothing. You get just like a thing full of junk they have to take to the dump anyway. But yeah, it was cheap and I thought it would be a hoot. I haven't had one in 20 years or so. But I posted it and all of a sudden everyone shows up. It's amazing.
I'd like to roll to metal and see if I can get some more information.
Yeah, go for it. Sounds like a presence roll. Do you have any items you'd like to use?
No, I think I'm just going to go for it.
Cool. Seven. Solid seven. Cool. Yeah, awesome. He goes off about the game and says, asks if you've played it. Haven't had a chance to yet, but says, people still come here and just, I am honestly doing quite well here. And there's something about like, people keep throwing quarters into it and, they don't last 5 minutes. So, that's great for me, but they don't stop playing. It's something else. I poked at it a little bit. I know it's not my jam. I've been playing video games my entire life, right? For like 30, 40 years. I've had my fill. Are you going to give this a shot?
Maybe. I think my friends are still holding our place in line. I just wanted to come and say good for you,
subscribe to like shot. Nintendo Power or any of those magazines or anything, right?
No, I don't. I'll check them out sometimes at the grocery store, but
well, there's they have game guides and stuff in there. When I put it in and like got the change slot and stuff, all the money making stuff in there hooked up, I found this, and he ruffles around his back pocket a little bit and just like unfolds. He's folded it two or three times, and it's actually a couple of lined notebook pages, paper, and he's like, take a look at this. Like, if this was in the machine, like there must be. It doesn't look like anything I've seen, but. It must be, someone who played it a lot, or I don't know, maybe whoever made it left it as a hint for someone. And the papers have like a bunch of labyrinths drawn on them. They all look kind of different, but they all share some like similar sections. But they're all totally different, as if like almost as if someone was like mapping something out, but like it changed on them while they were mapping it or something. So that's your clue there. Repeated drawings of a labyrinth, each one different from the next. And I think his emphaticness his enthusiasm for the game really rubbed off on you. And it's really kind of juiced you up about it. And I think you're going to take the condition obsessed with Zagreus. Like,
okay,
you're super into it now.
Perfect. I think I'd be like, oh, Ephraim, this is amazing. I've really got to play this game now.
You really
sold me on it. You're going to get my quarters, man. You're going to get these quarters.
You know, here, and you're like, ching, ching, ching. Chinks out a dollar's worth of quarters. Like, here, first three plays are on me. Go for it.
Perfect. I'll talk to you later. I'm going to get back to my friends.
Hey, what? Let me do it. And yeah, he walks off and starts getting on some kid who's doing something else.
Yeah, so I'm going to go back with Erica and Michael if they're still in line.
Yeah. So you're all are inside the arcade now. Erica and Michael, what are you up to there?
Oh, Michael's waiting to play.
Yeah. And it's not too long because people keep cycling through it. And you get up to it. And it is like I described before, it's like some guy, looks like, it's hard to tell because he's like really pixely. It looks like he might have like a little wreath around his head or something. Just like going through killing like little imp looking things in this cave. Again, it's, you know, 80s graphics, not super great. What, after hearing all the rumors and whatnot, what are you afraid might happen to you if you die in the game?
That I'll be marked by something, and I'll know that I was marked by something.
Awesome. I think this is gonna be a reason roll. You're pretty good at games, and you got a knack for it. So let's go ahead and do that.
Is this like its own roll, or is it just meddling?
Yeah, this is just a day move.
Okay, day move. All right, yeah. Cool. Perfect.
Eight. Great.
Ten.
Great.
Plus two.
Awesome. Yeah. So you actually last a lot longer than some of the other folks you're watching, and almost to the point where there's some folks around the machine, like half who are like cheering you on and half are like, come on, man, it's my turn already. And you actually get to, you know, you get past a few levels, fight a few mini bosses, and there's something you notice in the level that you kind of pass by. And it's like there's like an opening, like it's not really just like left to right side scroller, but one of the doorways looks different in the background, and it has some like pixelated writing above it you can't quite make out. And when you see that, that's when like one of the demons gets you, like one pops up from behind and another one like gives you a little spear and you explode in a little pixelated shower of blood, and the next person kind of pushes you off. But yeah, you got the high score on this thing, I think.
Sweet.
What about Erica?
I think Erica was definitely there, you know, relenting to watch Michael play Zagreus, you know, kind of doing the whole like kind of hunched over the shoulder thing. And as the, you know, as the game turns out that he's actually like doing really well at the game, you know, she's starting to get into it, you know, she'd be like, uh-huh, okay, yeah, that's pretty cool. But then when it's over and someone else comes, you know, like to get him out of the way, just goes, okay, that one wasn't so bad, but I think we need to ask around a bit more about this stuff. It's my turn. And this place is Dweeb Central, and they think she's a righteous dude.
Yes, they do. Yeah.
So Erica is going to head straight for the Terminator 2 cabinet. Nice. Put up a quarter beside the guy who's already there, and say, want to make a bet?
Yeah, it's yeah, some guy you don't recognize him, probably from out of town. He's like, yeah, sure. I don't think we're allowed to do that, but are we just like playing for quarters, or?
I'm playing for information.
Okay.
No, if I can top your high score, you tell me what you know about this whole UFO shit with Zagreus, because look, you're not from around here. You came to play Zagreus.
Oh, you got me. Yeah. But he does have like a Terminator, like an original Terminator shirt on. It looks faded, like he's had it for a long time. Awesome. Yeah, I'll tell you what to know. Let's play. Yeah, so go ahead and make that meddling move. I feel like this is going to be a reason move for playing the game.
Works for me. Maybe 6 plus. I have 1 or 2. I have none.
No reason at all.
No reason at all. Wow, it's a good thing. Woo! I have.
Yeah, so clearly this guy with the Terminator t-shirt is like, this is what he does. He may be here to see Zagreus, but like, he spent all his time on this. And you're not bad at it by any stretch of the imagination, but this guy is just a monster, and he like, you know takes out some of the robots and stuff, and then comes over to you and like blasts a bunch of things on your side, kind of like kill stealing from you. And you know, at the end of it, his score is like triple yours.
Oh no.
And he is kind of like, so we didn't say what I get when I win.
He just shrugs. So, what'd you get?
What I get?
You want a joint?
You know, how about we go smoke it somewhere together? Maybe you can give me your number or something. I'm not here for very long.
We could go smoke together and you could tell me about the UFOs.
I'll tell you everything I know. And he puts his arm around your shoulders and is like, let's go.
Whoa, 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 whoa. Dude, it's just the smoke.
Yeah, but you know, what do I get for winning?
You get a joint.
I can get a joint anywhere. Come on. You wouldn't have challenged me if you didn't have something.
I have no idea where to go with this.
Michael, you see this happening.
Yeah. Okay. I'll jump in then if you don't have any idea. I'll probably be like a couple of cabinets away, but when she does the whoa, whoa, whoa thing, you'll hear the exact same thing from like a couple of cabinets away, and he'll come like walking up like, what the fuck is going on, man? Are you good? Do you need, can I help you with something?
I don't know. Can I help you with something? I'm just talking to my lady friend here.
Yeah. That's my lady friend is the fucking problem that you're talking to.
It's your lady friend. I didn't see you get a high score on this.
Well, I don't need to fucking play Terminator 2, the arcade game, buddy. All right, I was playing Zagreus. Where's your score on that?
I haven't played it yet because I've been concentrating on working this angle, if you know what I mean. So just fuck off, all right?
Properly worked, my friend. Why don't you go back and watch some more James Cameron movies and shut your fucking mouth? How about that?
And he, you hear a click from about waist level, and he's like, why don't you fuck off before someone gets hurt? And he's pulled a switchblade on you.
Oh.
Well,
he's like, we're going to go out there and have some fun. And you can stay in here and do whatever you like.
I think that if his hands are down his waist, Michael will punch him right in the mouth.
Nice. yeah. What are you afraid might happen? I mean, I'm going to say you punch him. Yeah, I'm going to say you punch him either way. Okay. You think you're gonna get stabbed if you punch him?
I think if I fail the roll, I'm gonna get, I mean, nobody ever comes out of a knife fight without getting stabbed, so
yeah. Cool, this is definitely a vitality roll.
Boy, that escalated quickly.
Yeah, thanks, Mark. He pulled a knife on me in an arcade. This was supposed to be my safe place. I think that I'll probably, in the back of my mind, you know, in case anything really bad goes down, I got that lifeguard whistle in my pocket.
Nice. So are we doing three dice top two?
Three dice top two. Did you just want vitality?
To run into Bell today.
Yeah, this is vitality. So looks like you got
so just flat three.
So just flat.
Flat 3d6.
A nine.
Yeah. Four and eight.
Yeah. Same band there. Yeah. Yeah. So you deck him and he goes out, and like all of the, you know, there's noise everywhere in the arcade, but there's only arcade machine sounds now. Like everyone else has gone quiet. The knife is dropped on the floor. What do you do?
Well, definitely like kick the knife as far away as I can.
Cool. And just about when you do that, Ephraim comes up to like, hey, what's going on here? And like, the guy's like,
yeah, this guy pulled a fucking knife on me in your establishment.
I don't see a knife. Where?
I just kicked it right over there. I'll point to where I kicked it.
Oh, under the, I think you kicked it under an arcade machine accidentally.
Of course.
He's like, I don't see it. And he's just like, the other guy's got his hands on his face and he's just like gushing blood. And he's like, Ephraim's got his hands, you know, he's like 65 probably. So he's like trying to keep you apart. But just like, no fighting in here.
At this point, Erica, who is shaking, is you know, just going to pipe up and point at the guy on the ground and just yell, oh, wait, let me check the safety tab real quick here.
But yeah, I hope you have more of those shirts, asshole.
How is Erica going to address this accusation? Let me take a moment to think about this, because we do have a line.
Yeah. You can just say he was being a creep, or he was coming out too strong, or something like that.
Yeah, I guess that, you know, just pointing down at the guy on the ground, like, you know, this dude rolled in from out of town. We were just playing Terminator. He just, you know, he got really pushy, and he pulled a knife. I saw it, and my boyfriend punched him in the mouth, and now it's all good, and you should kick him out. Him.
You know what? I don't have time for any of this. I'm not Judge Judy or anyone. All three of you, you, Mr. Knifey, Mr. Punchy, and Terminator lady, all three of you out of here. We can't have you here anymore.
Does anybody want, well, the people that are in the ethereal plane, do you guys, does anybody want to do anything else? Because I'll actually turn a key to bump it to a 10.
Ooh, yeah.
Want to stay around here.
I'm fine with whatever.
I guess we
can. Yeah, and David's not getting kicked out for sure.
Yeah.
Exactly. and Parker's not part of this, so.
I guess you could stay. Yeah, you're good. Yeah. You're fine.
Yeah, I'll stay.
Sorry, we will still get a clue because of my move.
Yeah.
Even though we're shuffled out, we'll still get a clue. So I'm cool with the whole, you know, being shoved out of the arcade while Erica yells, "I'm friends with the sheriff. He's gonna hear about this."
Amazing.
I have one speed dial.
So he hustles the three of you out and like lets some more people in now that you're gone. Let me take a look at the clues.
Really funny if while this was all going on, Parker finally got their turn on Zagreus, and because they are just focused on that, they do not notice anything else that's that their friends are in danger or punching people. So if we can add that in, I think that would be funny.
Yeah, that's great. Yeah, so like the scene of like you doing that and that all happening in the background. I love that. And I think, yeah, Erica, as you're getting shuffled out, you're actually able to reach down and grab the knife, even though, you know, Ephraim's not having any of it. So you're able to like grab it and pocket it. And, you know, when you get out of the arcade, the guy's just like, fuck you guys, and takes off.
I know, I was thinking the same thing.
So you get the knife, and when you like take it out to look at it, it is covered in dried blood.
Huh. All right, this is not a my corner of this item. This is evidence.
This is evidence, yeah. This is a bloody knife, as a clue.
And Erica just closes her eyes, and she, you know, she's still like what kind of amped up from that, just closes her eyes and goes, I didn't want to run into the cops today.
David, you see all this happening. How are you reacting to it?
Kind of like, whoa, what the fuck? I want to follow this guy. Like, when you describe the dude with the glasses having a weird energy.
I mean, he's very enthusiastic. He's just like nerd guy who's like, I'm finally here at this place I've been dreaming about, and I'm going to tell everyone all my theories about it. Yeah, he's just like pumped.
Yeah, I just want to follow him around for a while.
Yeah. You know, he eventually gets onto Zagreus, and, you know, he cycles in and out a few times. He plays it, and, like, he is not good at it. So he winds up pumping, like, $40 into it over the course of however long. And, yeah, but he, like, it feels like his enthusiasm is still there, but, like, it's almost like he's exhausting himself doing it. Parker, how are you doing on Zagreus there?
Can I use the drawings of the labyrinth to see if I can get kind of far in the game? Like try to follow one of them.
Yeah. Interesting. Yeah. So the labyrinths don't match anything in the like levels that you can see, and you know you're getting further and further each way, each time you do it. I think I would like to do a day move for that and see if we can get you something. Are you so? Do you want to do? Are you intending to meddle with this one, or is this?
Yeah, just either just kind of see what happens. So yeah, it can be meddling move or it can be day move, whatever you think.
Yeah. Is best. Let's see. Yeah, let's make it a medal.
Sorry, real quick, is that a dog?
Is what a dog? Yeah, oh, that a dog?
Pug.
Yeah,
it's my. That's pug, a dog. Yes.
Oh my god.
He likes to bother me sometimes.
Yeah. Cool. Yeah, let's make this a reason. Meddling move.
Reason. Okay, so just two straight.
Yeah, I just want to use something.
Yeah, I got a seven.
A knife.
I got another knife.
Cool. Yeah. So you're not like you keep looking and you keep like trying to like interact with things that are clearly in the background. Don't do it, but you're starting to get really good at this, and you're just zoned right in. And you know, people are talking around you. And one of the things, you know, there's ridiculous nerds spouting off all sorts of stuff. One of the things that kind of like as you die once and pump your next quarter in, because you've like lined a bunch up, as you like take a break to like, and you're like resetting as the game starts up again, one of the jabbering, I think it's our friend Bart, who has the Zelda and the all your base stuff, he's like, yeah, I heard when they, you know, they had to like bring this thing in at night, and you know, a guy told me that he was at the food court, and he was listening to a security guard tell someone else that you know, they weren't allowed in the arcade when they were setting it up, but they like peeked in, and there is like a bunch of dudes in like black robes who are like setting it up and plugging it in and doing something with it. I don't know, man. You know, I've never seen aliens dress up in black robes or anything, but that's, you know, that's crazy stuff, right? I don't believe it, but that's what the guard told the guy, that the guy told me about. Yeah, weird, right?
I think Parker's taking them more seriously now. And it's like, I mean, if you were disguising the fact that you were an alien, wouldn't you wear a robe? And just like really believing what this guy is saying.
Yeah. Oh boy, yeah. And I think he like scoffs and he's like, clearly you haven't watched you know, this documentary that about aliens. Let's see for a second who we got here. Yeah. And I think, you know, when you turn back to the game, you see that you've run through all the quarters that you're up there, and someone puts a quarter up to play next, and he says, looks like I'm up after you, and the voice is familiar, and you turn around, and it is Deputy Gary just sort of leaning against the cabinet, just like beaming at you. I think we'll leave it there. I think that's a good place to end. an official shows up. I love me some video games. Awesome, that's fun. Let's just jump right into Stars and Wishes, and we'll start, we'll go backwards. Let's start with Sasha.
Well, first of all, that was a pretty intense beginning at school. Felt weird doing it at the beginning and ending in the middle. It did feel like such a climax. But yeah, the worker taking the shape of all our lost people was great. Really loved that. Also really appreciated when, you know, narrating how they noticed the absence of David following the absorption. That was really nice to see. Yeah, just overall, great session.
Awesome. Any wishes?
Explore more of what this chromatic desert thing means and how it works for my character.
Yeah, I'm curious about that as well. Great. Awesome. Thank you. Rue.
Bunch of stars for everyone, as always. I really liked the way that we solved the Deep Lake Lurker. Mark, thanks for just coming up with that. I don't know if you had ideas for that. I know you talked about that, but the pool scene was great, and the being kind of haunted by our fears and our past was really cool. For Ellie, I felt like Erica got a lot of characterization in this one. So like comforting Parker and realizing that like David was a part of her life was really cool. And all of that. I also really liked how you played out the whole like creepazoid scene in the arcade. I thought that was handled nicely. For Sasha, I love that David just jumped in with violence again. That was really funny. And how you handled the Polly scene. I like that it was real for your character. And also the fact that I'm excited to see what you do with the Chromatic Desert. And then for Billy, I really liked how you and I worked together as Parker and Michael during the pool scene. And then also, I'm just because I'm shipping Michael and Erica, I really like the, like, you guys said boyfriend. And then for wishes, I do want to watch a Odyssey tape next time so we can get some David, I guess, communication or however yeah. that works. And do more of the, what is it called? The, oh, do the Greetings Traveler. I guess, see what's going on there.
Awesome. Thank you. Yeah, that's it. Michael. I'm sorry, Ellie.
Stars for Seth, David, my guy. I was not expecting you to. I mean, I know he's not out of the action, but I knew you were speed running, but I wasn't expecting it tonight. So huge stars for how all that went down. The whole stuff with him and Erica finally having a bonding moment to lead to friendship later, and then her completely forgetting she ever existed was she doesn't care, but wow, that was a punch and a knife twist all in one. But it was really that was really nice. I'll miss him a lot. He had stars for sure for Parker for just kind of picking up and rolling with the whole things aren't right in the house now. I loved the window. That really, really stuck with me. I love Cold Affairs at the mall. I totally want to shop there for cheap stuff. Billy, the whole like transferring Michael's obsession with, you know, getting really fixated on a particular movie to being like super fixated on Zagreus was fantastic. I love it. Stars for Mark as always. That was that really was all dialed up to 11. You handled it with very expertly as usual. So I'm definitely excited to see what comes next. I'm mildly disappointed I don't have a free switchblade, but I have plot instead. So that is always the better trade-off for a free knife. And wishes, well, I won't be here next week, so don't have too much fun without me.
Cool, thank you. And Billy.
I had a lot of fun. I really liked the kicking it off at the Apex thing. I was like really busy this week and right up until the session today, so I totally forgot where we were gonna start. So it was perfect. And I just, all the imagery was great. I love the pool stuff. That was super awesome. And the I noticed that it could be because I haven't given that much of a backstory, because I am surprisingly unscathed when it comes to conditions and keys. But Michael came out of the lake with nary a traumatic experience other than the general traumatic experience. But yeah, so star for all those NPCs. That was so great to see everybody doing that. Parker and Michael worked together really well again, and it was really cool to kind of split off and do that. And then him like doing the immediate stupid thing of getting in the pool, and then Parker's like, yeah, let's just like drain the thing. That was perfect. And Sasha, I actually took a cue from him with the scene at the end, because it's like, I'm just gonna punch this thing right in the face. And I just wanted to, like, you know, I wanted to be the third person that just handled something by punching it in the face. So I figured that was great, and it always seems to work out so well. And of course, the turning the chromatic desert, that was great, because I had read the move or the key a long time ago, and I was always curious how it will turn the entire game upside down, pretty much. So it was very cool idea to just dive headfirst, no pun intended. And of course, Ellie going to get some information and challenging some guy, and then subsequently just getting your ass whooped on the machine was perfect. Don't play the Terminator shirt guy at Terminator, I guess, but it led to some really cool stuff, and I was glad to play that up a little bit. And it was also cool to see her begrudgingly open up to Zagreus a little bit, for better or worse, because she like hung out with Michael while he was playing. And yeah, wishes, just I want to watch an Odyssey tape so I can see how we can fit the clues into the Odyssey tapes.
Yeah, awesome. Cool. Yeah, I had a great time. I had like one idea for the Lurker stuff, but wound up not using it. So I'm using a little bit of it, but not the main part of it. But it was really fun. Once you got the pool thing, I was like, oh yeah, that's, I didn't realize until later on, like, oh, that's how they can get back. Great. Okay, good. Water, good. It's all good. Like, I'm picturing like these like control rods people thing going on. But it's like that all came together really nice. all the things everyone said, great stuff. The like chromatic desert, I'm so into finding out what all that means. Super super baller move. I had something for Parker. What was it? Similarly, like just going for something. I don't remember what it was. It'll come to me. Everyone felt just like going all the way with where you're at. So that was a lot of fun to watch, and a lot of fun discoveries. I'm happy to. I've been like dying to do Zagreus. I think this is gonna be a super fun mystery. So I'm just happy to like see stuff just like chugging along and also being super fun in the process. I think my wishes similarly are watching an Odyssey tape, get some David action, and find out what all that means. And maybe see if anyone else comes over for a movie night. Who knows? I think that's all I've got. What was the Parker thing? I'll remember it. I'll post it later. Cool. Anything else before we wrap it up? Awesome. Amazing session as always. Thanks y'all for playing. Thanks to anyone who is watching, and we will see most of you next time. I'm not going to end the meeting. I'm just going to stop the stream. Bye.